arrived today at 3 p.m., so it's been a little bit of an adventure already. And I admit that I'm here by the graciousness and kindness of many people in this country, so I hope to repay that kindness while I'm here. My name is Keith Roper. I'm from University of Arkansas. Recently finished working at the National Science Foundation for 4 years. And I'll talk today about some work that was funded primarily by the National Science Foundation, but also by the Environmental Protection Agency in the United States, about enhanced catalysis using optical nano antennas that are reduced on transition metal dichalcogenides. My collaborators in this work primarily have been Dr. Jeremy Dumplin and Alexander O'Brien, who is a student at the University of Arkansas. We have a number of affiliations there. And so let's go ahead and get started. I'll also be presenting work from Dr. Dean DeJarnett, who's with the Department of Energy, Dr. Greg Porcario, who's with the Army Research Laboratory, Philip Blake with the State of Arkansas, Braden Harbin, Dr. Philip Blake, I should say, and Dr. Murad Benamara from the Institute for Nanoscience and Nanotechnology. You'll see their pictures when their work comes up. So our interest in this work has been production of renewable sources of energy by photocatalysis, essentially. And currently there are two methods for doing this. The first method, which it sounds like you've heard about, I caught a little bit of talk as I just came in, is oxidation at semiconducting anodes under an applied voltage. And the second method is direct redox, where a semiconducting photocatalyst is combined with platinum to trap electrons and reduce recombination. There are some challenges or barriers with these methods. The first is that the carriers that are generated are uncontrolled. Recombination is inevitable, and that reduces the efficiency of these methods. And the second barrier is that so far, the photocatalysis have incomplete solar absorption. So for example, titanium dioxide, as we mentioned a bit earlier, has a direct band gap that's on the order of 3.2 electron volts. And so that's in the UV range. We've got quite a bit of energy below that. So we have looked at semiconducting nanocrystals, in particular two-dimensional transition metal dichalcogenides, and compared them with some early work that was done with some other nano scale semiconductor crystals. Two-dimensional transition metal dichalcogenides have the advantage of being earth abundant. By exfoliation, it's possible to break the weak van der Waals forces into bulk material and come up with a satisfactory nanoscale material. These are efficient direct band gap light absorbers with energy ranges on the order of about 2 electron volts, which gives them a very efficient luminescent response to be measured and characterized, as well as strong catalytic activity at the edge sites, corresponding to disulfide concentration both at edges and at terraces. And you can see here that these dichalcogenides have a chemical formula given by MX2, where the transition metal that we've looked at have been tungsten and molybdenum, and your chalcogenide is typically sulfur and selenium and tellurium. I'll give some examples of others as well. So you can take this bulk material, which has an indirect band gap on the order of 1.3 electron volts. You can exfoliate that and prepare monolayer crystals that have a direct band gap on the order of 2 electron volts. Okay. Because you can obtain nanoscale crystals, you can enhance the optoelectronic properties relative to the bulk material, maximize your reactive surface area, and decrease the length that your carriers travel to achieve your photocatalytic interaction. The alternative to these dichalcogenides has been quantum dots. Quantum dots provide quantum confinement, which gives them a unique band structure. You can use them to photosensitize solar harvesting and extract the carriers. They bring exciton energy to a circuit by absorbing the infrared and UV, depending on the size and other characteristics of the quantum dots. And I'll give some examples of some common binary quantum dots here. However, there have been limitations to using both transition metal dichalcogenides as well as these quantum dots. And in particular, monolayer transition metal dichalcogenides are limited by uneconomic fabrication methods. So primarily, it's been the use of mechanical exfoliation, chemical exfoliation, or chemical ceramic exfoliation gives you limited size range on the order of less than about a micron with an uncontrolled number of flakes or size of flakes in particular. Chemical exfoliation will actually change from a 2H to a 1T metal and requires re-immunity to get back to a semiconductor. Chemical vapor deposition, there's been considerable progress in this area. However, it's expensive, difficult to scale, and may not be well suited for the type of renewable energy application that we're interested in until the cost of that fabrication process goes down. But perhaps more importantly, from a fundamental perspective, is that they have untunable optoelectronics to this point. Difficult to generate carriers in this material, and then more difficult to control the dynamics of the carriers once they're decorated. On the other hand, quantum dots have issues with fluorescent blinking, which lowers their efficiency due to radiated recombination, as well as multiple interactions between carriers and photons, which provide opportunities for down conversion and up conversion, but also excludes part of your solar spectrum. So we began looking at tackling some of these issues with two approaches. The first approach is a liquid exfoliation method. So I worked with Jonathan Coleman, who was at University College Dublin and one of the pioneers in the area of liquid exfoliation to develop methods that were well suited to the dichalcogenides and to use those in developing these nanoantenna materials. The second approach that we've taken is to decorate these dichalcogenides with nanoantenna to form heterostructures. And that gives us the ability to begin to look at controlling the generated carriers as well as controlling the carrier dynamics. And so we'll give some particular examples of that. What the liquid exfoliation allows us to do is bypass some of the inherent challenges associated with chemical exfoliation. We can produce a 2H material that's semiconducting from liquid exfoliation without nearly the size and the geometric constraints that the chemical exfoliation gives. Nanoantennas, of course, have been considered very carefully over the past decade, and also have the possibility of potentially controlling carrier dynamics with quantum dots as well, but we didn't take that on the study. We're just looking at the dichalcogenides. Okay, so we use this liquid phase exfoliation to produce nanocrystals of both tungsten and molybdenum disulfide, but you can also use it for the other dichalcogenides, with graphene, hexagonal boron nitride, and black phosphorus, other nanocrystals, for example. The method that we use consists of an initial 90-minute sonication, followed by a two-hour centrifugation at 4,000 RPMs. That allows us to do some preliminary removal of contaminants. That's followed by the bulk sonication over 12 hours, and then a series of centrifugations in order to do size separation. So increasing the RPMs, 2,000, 4,000, 6,000, 10,000, and then alternately discarding it and then collecting the precipitate, resuspending that, and re-centrifuging it again in order to achieve size separation. And this shows some of the vials of the final products for tungsten and molybdenum disulfide. So we took this material and then coated it on three electrode to test hydrogen evolution lactam, a little bit similar to what was done in the previous talk. We used a standard three electrode configuration there, and our cell consisted of 0.5 molar sulfuric acid with 3 molar sodium chloride. We had a glassy carbon electrode, which was our working electrode, had a diameter of 3 millimeters. Our reference electrode was silver chloride, and our counter electrode was a graphite rod. You can see the setup here. And then we doped our working electrode with an ink, 1.5 microliters for that. That ink consisted of Nafion ionomer, an amount of the dichalcogenide. I'll be showing results with tungsten dichalcogenide today, tungsten disulfide, and Ketjen black in order to increase the conductivity. And then we used a potentiostat to negative 5 millivolts per second linear sweep, 20 cycles cyclic method as well, and we cycled that at 0 to about minus 800 millivolts versus the silver chloride electrode. This gives you the calculation for determining the relative hydrogen. So this shows you the results for the cyclic voltammetry. You can conceived at a value of negative 500 versus RHE, we're getting a current density on the order of 65 milliamps per centimeter squared. We have an onset potential on the order of about 250 millivolts at a minus 300, an onset potential between minus 250 and 300 millivolts. And this shows you the results referenced with both just the background as well as the background with the catching added. So you can see there's a significant difference when the catalyst is added to that leaking electrode. This shows you an actual photograph of the hydrogen evolution that's produced in the course of photocatalysis here, and quite a heavy bubbling reaction. And with respect to what's been reported in the literature to date for tungsten disulfide, these nanocrystals that were formed with liquid exfoliation gave a threefold increase in the peak current density and a 25% increase in the onset potential. So these are preliminary results. We were excited that we had such significant increases over what's been reported in the literature today. This work was done by Jill and Alex primarily. So if we look at linear sweep voltammetry, we were getting peak current densities on the order of minus 80 milliamps per centimeter squared, minus 500 millivolts versus the hydrogen electrode, and an onset potential between minus 250 and 300 millivolts. And you can see that for the three runs that I've shown, there's a little bit of difference out here in the range, which you'll find that most people in the literature don't report. So you're definitely seeing some breakdown right there. But consistency with respect to the onset potential and in the slopes of these particular graphs. This is just giving you a blow of the onset potential. And so, again, relative to literature, where they've excluded this region right here, which gets rather noisy, we see a 3 to 4-fold increase in our peak current density, and about a 25% increase in our onset potential. So while this is interesting and certainly points to the effectiveness of this new liquid exfoliation method, still haven't overcome the problem of being able to control the local current generation as well as the dynamics. And so we then turn to looking at the nano antenna. And so just a little bit of background on nano antenna, nanocrystal heterostructures. It's known, it's been reported in the literature, that it's possible to control carrier generation and energetics in a number of ways. So for example, we can intensify the local electromagnetic field. I'll talk about that more in just a bit. That has the potential for reducing carrier recombination. We can thermalize locally due to plasmas, which I'll also talk about in a minute, and that could increase our reaction kinetics. We also have the possibility for in situ reduction in nanoparticles on the surface, and that can pedo our transition metal type chalcogenide. So potential advantages in all these. And in fact, it's been reported in a number of places already in the literature that transition metal dichalcogenides do increase your photocatalytic hydrogen evolution. In this particular example, was with gold nano antenna on a two-dimensional transition metal dichalcogenide. It's been reported that the photoluminescence can be enhanced 11-fold in tungsten disulfide due to nano antenna, that you can actually measure increased photocurrent in molybdenum disulfide field effect transistors, and that you can induce a 2H to 1T transition when you inject hot electrons, and that's been shown in 2D transition metal dichalcogenide. So these are some of the results that are already seen in the literature, and this is just showing you the cover page those are reported. It's also been shown in quantum dots that you can suppress the blinking and increase the radiating decay rates of the quantum dots, and you can enhance multi-exciton emission. So that was interesting as well. So a little bit of background. My group has been working in this area of nano antenna for over a dozen years now. The fundamental idea here with plasmonic nano antenna is that you're localizing an electromagnetic field to a significant subwavelength region. That's possible because of the metal dielectric interface, where you're able to substantially reduce the size of the electromagnetic field and intensify. At that interface, you have a frequency-dependent dielectric constant with a real and imaginary part that are sufficiently different from your surrounding dielectric that gives rise to that localized field. And the electron coupling occurs within 1 to 2 nanometers of that interface, and you can get an enhanced near-field interaction that extends out to about 3 to 100 nanometers from that interface. There are some limitations that we've been working hard to overcome over the past decade in using Plasmon. The first one is that these tend to have a very narrow excitation band corresponding to Plasmon frequency. You get significant losses due to electron hole recombination because of that local field and the metallization there. And you also get significant energy thermal energy. And so we've been looking at ways to overcome these. There is particularly low energy tunability. They're geometry dependent and near fields are localized. And hindering progress in this area is the fact that there are very few compact multi-scale models to help design and guide fabrication. So we've developed models corresponding with physical data that allow us to show, for example, that you can increase the surface area to volume ratio with different designs of nanostructures, and you can redshift the plasmon frequency from optical into the infrared, try to recover some of that solar irradiation out in the infrared. You can do the same thing by structuring your nano antenna, for example, and taking advantage of lattice resonances, interactions, photonic interactions between the plasmons, and get a redshift that way, as well as an increased overall energy band there. We've shown by coupling the discrete dipole and coupled dipole approximation methods that you can describe the plasmon-supported nano antenna in these various structures and generate not only band gaps across a wide range, but very unique band structures. And this has to do with the polarization and the dependence on the polarization of your photonic interaction as well as your atomic interaction to polarize through. And this new computational approach that we've developed allows us to both predict these band structures, speed the design of the nanomaterials, and directly attribute the properties of those new materials to the geometry, the wavelength, the energy values, as well as the corresponding optoelectronic features of the materials. So that's been quite satisfying. But let's talk about how this affects the dipole cosmos now. So we used a direct reduction method to decorate the nanoparticles simply by mixing gold-3 with a suspension of dichel cogeni and allowing that reduction to take place over time, followed by centrifugation to get rid of the excess gold and then a collection of the recentrifuge material in a second centrifugation. And the result of that is shown in this diagram. So here we're doing an optical analysis, which shows that as you increase the content of gold relative to your dichel cogeni in this mixture, that you can significantly increase this characteristic plasmon peak. And you'll notice that the plasmon peak overlaps both the A exciton at about 640 nanometers or so, 630 nanometers, as well as the B exciton, and eventually overshadows the B exciton completely for the tungsten disulfide. And this shows you the range of colors that are correspond to the associated gold content. The result is that you get a redshifted B exciton peak, complete masking of the A exciton peak, and a significantly enhanced optical extinction, which has promise for spanning your solar radiation. This panel shows you that you, by adjusting the ratio of the gold, that you can significantly change the color contrast as we show here, but also start to fine tune the interaction of the plasmon with the A exciton and the B exciton. And we'll show in just a second, this additional cascade centrifugation allowed us to remove aggregates. So what we're ending up now with is monolayer or few layer dichel cogenides that are decorated with the gold just around the periphery. And so I have some images of that to show next. So here's an example. This is your dichel cogenide, and you can see it's virtually a monolayer with maybe one terrace, possibly two terraces there, and your reduction takes place around the periphery. Here you have nanoparticles that are basically two different sizes, one approximately on the order of 10 nanometers, and then a smaller group that is approximately on the order of 1 to 2 nanometers. A hypothesized reaction here is that we're getting a reduction of the gold chloride, which is oxidizing our free or dangling sulfur groups around the edges primarily and on some of these terraces here, and then producing a disulfide. And that disulfide is the catalytic agent that increases your hydrogen evolution reaction. And so this gives you a close-up view to show the crystal structure of both the dichalcogenide here as well as those gold atoms. And I have a few more graphs that just show close-ups of the decorated dichalcogenides here. We get both spherical as well as, in some cases, these prismatic structures. We're sorting into why we get these different shapes right now. This work is involved in other people. So now we're going to compare the results with cyclic and linear voltammetry with the undecorated tungsten disulfide and see what happens. And so if we do that, the cyclic voltammetry, we get a peak current density of minus 25 milliamps per square centimeter at minus 350 millivolts versus our hydrogen electrode. And we get an onset potential that's quite similar, minus 200 millivolts to minus 250 millivolts. But if we take those values and we now compare that with other dichalcogenide on the basis of size and thickness, we find out that we get almost an order of magnitude enhancement on a current density per thickness relative to a variety of other dichalcogenides. And that's a pretty significant increase, especially for preliminary data. So we're really excited about this ability that separating with these metal nano antenna has given us to increase the catalytic efficiency. I won't go into too much detail. I can certainly respond to questions if you like in terms of now doing the prediction of this result using discrete dipole approximation and our computation methods to be able to understand what's going on. But in essence, we've looked at these nano antenna both on the basal plane as well as on the edges, and we can show that decorating on the edges increases or has a significant enhancement to the A exciton, not showing the results for the B exciton there, as well as this plasmonic enhancement. And that could be resulting in the localization of the near field and also enhancing some catalysis, since that work is ongoing right now. We've actually done simulations not only of ideal structures but real structures. So we took this real structure that I showed you, the TEM up, we discretized that and formed a discrete dipole approximation and showed that, in fact, that structure gives you an enhancement of the A exciton as well as the plasma P. And so exciting results with those simulations. So in conclusion, we've shown preliminary results that indicate that transition metal dichalcogenides can enhance hydrogen evolution reaction by threefold. Using this new liquid phase exfoliation method relative to mechanical exfoliation or a chemical vapor deposition in particular, we've shown that by adding nano antenna to those heterostructures, we can increase that by more than another threefold relative to a variety of other transition metal dichalcogenides that have been decorated with nano antenna. And we hypothesize that's due to this increased disulfide content that's associated with the reduction of the gold on the edges. Haven't looked at the optoelectronics of that yet. We're excited to start doing that. And we do have an electrodynamic basis for this. We've shown with our modeling that we should see an enhancement in both the A exciton interaction as well as the plasma interaction on the edge side relative to the basic plane. So that, I'd like to thank my collaborators on this group, a number of funding sources who have supported our work over the years, and be happy to address any questions. Thank you.
So that the time